De-extinction is more about the preservation of species that are on the brink than it is bringing species back. We're not gonna have a Jurassic Park scenario here, folks. That is the first time that a dire wolf has howled in 10,000 years.
On the path to all of our de-extinction projects, we try to pair the animal we're de-extincting with that of its like closest living relative or cousin species that's threatened. And you probably know about a lot about red wolves, right? And there was a recent article that came out talking about red wolves and their population collapse. Well, one of the things that we invented was actually cloning from blood. So the cloning process is typically moderately invasive, right? You have to take like an ear punch. It's a pretty invasive process from an animal welfare perspective. We have now been able to isolate a specific type of cell in blood and clone from that. No one's ever done that.
Yep, they did it. Those are not special effects. Definitely not AI. There's no question about it. Those are living, breathing animals. But are they dire wolves? And what does this mean for conservation? Let's dive in. By this point, I'm sure you guys have seen all over the internet the trending videos, the trending articles, and the news that Colossal Biosciences has brought back the dire wolf. De-extinction is here, ladies and gentlemen. And as a wildlife presenter, I think it's only fair that I bring you guys this side of the story from the Brave Wilderness perspective. Now, for a little bit of background context, we have been working with Colossal Biosciences for the past year. I had the amazing opportunity to visit their facility in Dallas, Texas, sat down with CEO Ben Lamm to talk about this project.
Dinosaurs. Will it ever be possible?
So we get this question a lot.
Sat down with Chief Science Officer Beth Shapiro.
Genetic engineering at its very simplest is really just our ability to go into a genome, and that is the chromosomes that live inside the nucleus of our cells, and make tiny little tweaks to the sequence of A's and C's and G's and T's that will hopefully have some effect on how an organism looks or acts or tastes or runs around, something like that.
And the head of their animal research team, Matt James.
We're really talking about creating expansive biosecure facilities that cover thousands of acres that can replicate these Pleistocene era ecosystems in a really cool way. And what dire wolf represents is this amazing symbol of hope for us to be able to show, here's the power of technology, here's what humans can do for wildlife today.
I gotta say, the work that they're doing there at Colossal is phenomenal. And I learned so much in my time spent with them. And at this time, they did not officially have a dire wolf yet. So it's only fair for me to say, was I skeptical? I saw a lot of cool stuff in the lab, saw a lot of cool things in petri dishes, but were they actually going to pull it off? Yes, it appears that they have. Now, the footage that you guys have seen for the past couple of weeks is historical. But what is a dire wolf? Like, we gotta start right at the top. For most of us, we think of the dire wolf as being something that was in Game of Thrones, right? A giant wolf that was vicious and could rip the head off of a man in a single bite. But truth be told, dire wolves were not nearly as big as Game of Thrones made them out to be. In fact, they weren't much bigger than the largest gray wolves that we have today. Now, they lived between 125,000 and 10,000 years ago in the late Pleistocene era. But when it came to the extinction of these animals, it wasn't necessarily due to anything that was human-oriented, but more so a competition for resources. Large herbivores that these wolves would have been feeding on began to die out. Therefore, it made it more difficult for these wolves to evolve, and therefore we got the gray wolf. And that's where this whole story begins. How close the gray wolf is to the actual dire wolf. So before we get into what de-extinction is, let's just talk about an animal that's been pushed to the brink of extinction, the wolf. Now, Colossal Biosciences is getting attention for bringing back the dire wolf, this de-extinction process. But the truth is, de-extinction is leading towards conservation of things like the gray wolf, and specifically for Colossal Biosciences, the American red wolf. Now, what you may not know is the American red wolf is on the brink of extinction currently. You guys know that over the years, we've done a lot to try to support wolf conservation. I got the chance to work with the Colorado Wolf and Wildlife Center and a number of other wolf groups. I've been in enclosures with wolves. I've seen them up close and personal. They're beautiful animals. But since the dawn of mankind, they have had a villainous reputation. Why have they been painted like that? I don't know. Is it because they have teeth? Is it because they hunt in packs? Is it because they howl at the moon? No matter what your opinion is about wolves, wolves are incredibly important to our ecosystem.
I think people struggle with the idea that there are carnivores that they have to share space with. And this is one of the reasons that carnivorous species have been among the most likely to go extinct in evolutionary history. But we now know a lot more, and people have gotten so much more in tune with how important ecosystems are to be robust and biodiverse in order to be sustainable, that I think there's a lot of sort of regret that sits in us, in many of us, that says, we should still have more of these carnivores that are around. We should still have more of these predators. We have really messed with ecosystems in such a way that everything is really out of balance. And I think a lot of the push from the conservation community to really have wolves be reintroduced into these areas comes from this feeling like ecosystems are healthier and they're more robust and they're biodiverse when you have the predator in the ecosystem.
So there were two pieces of important genetic material that their scientists were able to extract from: a single direwolf tooth and a direwolf skull, where they pulled DNA from something known as the petrous bone.
It's a great DNA storage, better than teeth, better than anything.
Which is inside the ear region and is incredibly dense. Now, the scientists were able to extract enough of the genome sequence, so the code that makes up a direwolf, that tells us this is what a direwolf looked like. And then they were able to find the most similar genetic code to the direwolf, which of course is the gray wolf. This is where it gets a little complicated.
What we do is we map all of our tiny little pieces of DNA to the wolf genome, right? And then we decide which of those differences that exist between gray wolf and direwolf, because there are a lot of them, which of them are actually important to making a direwolf look more like a direwolf than like a gray wolf. We can't make all of the changes. Technologically, right now, it's not feasible. There would be many millions of changes that we would have to make in order to do all of it. So instead, we're using this gray wolf genome as a surrogate, a genomic surrogate, and then we're gradually cut and pasting our way using the tools of gene editing from a gray wolf to something that is much more direwolf-like, our direwolf, by selecting which bits of direwolf are important to making a direwolf, and adding those to the gray wolf genome.
However, it didn't just stop there. Learning that science and figuring out that genetic code was only the first piece of the puzzle. Next, they had to take that genetic material and do something called somatic cell nuclear transfer. It's essentially the same thing as cloning.
When people think about de-extinction, often the first thing they think of is cloning, this process that most famously brought us Dolly the sheep. But cloning requires a living cell. And once an organism dies, there are no more living cells. As soon as death happens, all sorts of things collude to break down the cells and to break up the DNA inside those cells into smaller and smaller pieces until eventually there's nothing left. Once an animal dies, there is no way to bring an identical copy of that thing incredibly back to life.
Many of these embryos didn't become successful, but the ones that were successful were then surgically implanted into a surrogate dog. These dogs were specifically selected based on their size and their health to be able to essentially, within them, grow direwolf puppies, and thus Romulus, Remus, and Khaleesi were born.
Domestic dogs are gray wolves. They're just relatively recently diverged evolutionary offshoots of gray wolves. And so this is the second way that our gray wolf has become a surrogate to our direwolf.
Okay, so because of the genetics of all dogs that technically have a percentage of wolfiness in them, you're able to develop puppies inside of just a common dog species that when they come out will look like and eventually grow into a modern day direwolf.
I'm gonna go as far and say that dogs don't have a percentage of wolfiness.
Okay.
Dogs are wolves.
Dogs are wolves. Which is, okay, I'm gonna come back to that in a second. So,
they're special wolves.
Yeah,
they're
special
domesticated wolves.
Domesticated wolves.
Hopefully that helps make sense of taking genetic material, breaking it down, figuring out the code, putting it in a cell, putting it in a dog, and boom, you've got a direwolf pup. Guys, I know this sounds like science fiction, but it is science fact. And Colossal Biosciences has successfully pushed the limits of genetic editing and has brought us back the direwolf, which essentially is going to set up the future of conservation, ensuring that species don't necessarily ever go extinct again. That is a pretty big accomplishment right there. One other really cool thing that Colossal Biosciences did is they partnered with the American Humane Society. So the surrogate dogs that carried the dire wolf pups now have forever homes. So these dogs, which are kind of kept private at the moment, are incredibly special because they are the very first animals that have been able to carry an extinct species and successfully bore it back into life, which kind of crazy to wrap your brain around, but I just want everybody to know that the dogs that actually birthed these dire wolf pups are in good homes and in good hands. So once they had figured out the genome editing and they successfully were able to impregnate a surrogate dog, the success rate thus far has been three dire wolves. Romulus and Remus, who are both about 6 months old now, and Khaleesi. She is the female. Romulus and Remus are brothers. You can see, if you know wolves, you can see a bit of the difference. A thicker coat, especially up on their backs. Bigger legs, a little bit more stocky. And one of the differences between the dire wolf and the gray wolf is a bigger, stockier body structure and head. The skulls were just a little bit bigger on a dire wolf than they are a gray wolf. Wow. I am looking at the first two dire wolves that were brought back from de-extinction. And they are only half grown at this point. That's what's wild. Currently, Romulus and Remus weigh around 85 pounds. They predict that they will be close to 150 pounds when fully grown. So they're a little bit bigger than a gray wolf technically, but not that much bigger. It's not like you've got Ghost or some of the other wolves from Game of Thrones. I think it's fascinating, and I think it's really positive. And of course, this is not the Jurassic Park scenario. I know a lot of people were like, oh my gosh, is this that Ian Malcolm moment where the scientists were too preoccupied as to whether or not they could? They didn't stop to think whether or not they should. This is not that. It's not extracting DNA from a mosquito, mixing it with frog DNA, and bringing back a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
There is no DNA for dinosaurs preserved. One of our top advisors, Kenneth Lacavara, who discovered Dreadnoughtus, he has found ways to demineralize bones where you get basic amino acids, right? But you know, it's not like we're getting big chunks of DNA or what. It's just not preserved, right? Right now, we can go back a little over a million years, but that's a big jump from a million years to 65 million years. So it's not just DNA degradation rate, but it's also just fossils. Like, that DNA doesn't exist. It's just rock, right? And you cannot get DNA from rock.
Now, for those of you that think we're going to have packs of dire wolves running across the United States, let me first just dispel that myth. That is not what Colossal Biosciences' intention is. These wolves are all going to be living on a very expansive ecological preserve. Over 2,000 acres where these wolves will get to live the way that wolves do. But the intention is not to create packs of dire wolves. It was to prove that de-extinction is possible. I personally think it would be amazing if we did not have species disappearing off the face of the planet due to human impact. Species do go naturally extinct all the time, but it's the ones that we specifically have driven to the brink that end up being the most catastrophic stories. I think it's companies like Colossal Biosciences who are using these advancing genetic technologies along with media and along with moments like the dire wolves being brought back from extinction that really create a positive narrative for the future of conservation. The entire goal of this dire wolf project is to bring attention to the American red wolf and how these animals are on the brink, yet with these technologies, we are finding a way to prevent their extinction as we move forward. What do you guys think about it? What would it be like if we lived in a world where animals were no longer going extinct?
When you look at the world of synthetic biology, I think that we are at the very doorsteps of it, right? And so I think that the technologies that not just Colossal, but many other labs are developing will change everything from human healthcare to de-extinction to conservation. So I don't know what the limitations of synthetic biology is, but I do believe that there'll be some end state to the technology where we can almost have like the CAD software of biology where we can engineer, you know, anything. That doesn't mean we should engineer everything, but we will have that. We as humanity will have those capabilities. And I just think that it will be the most transformative technology that humanity may ever possess is kind of the power over the genome.
Now, if you've got your thoughts and opinions, I certainly encourage you to write in the comments section below, and we'll do our best to answer as many of those questions as we possibly can. Now, I certainly encourage you to go follow Colossal Biosciences' social media links and specifically their YouTube channel. There you can watch Romulus, Remus, and Khaleesi grow up on the expansive ecological reserve. And with any luck, at some point in the near future, I will be there at the reserve getting to actually see these animals with my own eyes. So there you have it, guys. Direwolves, back from extinction, and the future of conservation is before us. It's an exciting time, and I can't wait to be a part of it. I'm Coyote Peterson. Be brave. Stay wild. We'll see you on the next adventure.